Hello everyone, I wanted to make a video today on how to install Android x86 on Microsoft's Hyper-V. So why am I writing this, or why am I making this tutorial? Was basically because there was a lack of available information available online on the Android x86 discussion group, and I decided to make a concise tutorial to help fellow devs or anyone who wants to tinker, explore and run Android x86 under Microsoft's Hyper-V. Especially since after Windows 8.0, Hyper-V has been available on workstation builds of Windows. So you no longer need Windows Server to run Hyper-V. So it's baked right in and you don't have to install, for example, VMware, workstation, or even VirtualBox. So just a note, this isn't for the faint of heart. The mouse and pointer integration kind of sucks in Hyper-V. So do not expect to run your favorite apps or games under Hyper-V. This tutorial is mainly for technical reasons, just to get it out there and help other people along. And your mileage may vary. Like I said, this is mainly for devs or people debugging who want to run ADB and just want to have Android running under Hyper-V just to gain a little bit performance boost. Also, this tutorial assumes you already have Hyper-V installed, as is in my case, and you already have your switches configured. So first, let's go to the Android x86 website and we'll download the latest release. As of the time of when I made this video, the latest is Android x86 6.0 release 2. Go ahead and download this. I already have it downloaded, so I won't go through the trouble. But you can get it from right here. I'll be using the 64-bit version if you don't have hardware acceleration or hardware virtualization. You'll be stuck with using the 32-bit ISO. There's not much of a difference unless, of course, you want more than 4 gigs of RAM. But even in my case, I won't be using more than 1.5 gigs. So we can go ahead and close this. And now let's go ahead and create a new virtual machine. Sorry, move this over. We'll name it Android x86 6.0 R2. Go ahead and click next. Now, this needs to be a generation 1 machine. A generation 2 VM will not work properly with the release due to an EFI boot bug. If you do try it with Gen 2, you'll only be able to boot off the live CD and not actually install. So that's a caveat you need to pay attention to. Just generation 1, and we'll have to use IDE disks. Startup memory, a gig is usually enough. You can decide to use dynamic memory if your machine has enough. If it doesn't, I would suggest against using this, especially if you're running on a machine that has less than, like, say, 8 gigs of RAM. Configure your network. I already have an external switch set up. You can also use an internal switch if you just want local access and no outside access for the VM. That's a safer option. Now we're going to create a hard disk. Choose a reasonable size, guys. Like, I'm not going to waste 127 gigs on Android. Something like 15 gigs should be enough. Next, we're going to install the OS. Now, from that ISO file you downloaded earlier, go ahead and browse to where you saved it. Here I have mine saved under an ISOs folder. Go ahead, double-click it, click Next, then click Finish. Wait for the new VM to build. Now we can actually start the installation, but I want to adjust one thing in the settings, and that is the maximum memory consumption. So go ahead, go under memory, and see how the maximum RAM is like some ridiculous 100 terabyte value. Just go ahead and, since I chose 1024, I'll just add half a gig, so this will be 1536. Just so the VM is not wasting, you know, a lot of memory for no reason. You can go ahead and connect. And let's start the VM. So this is where the installation process is going to start. And there's actually a few things we need to pay attention to. First of all, we want to actually install. We'll load the kernel, and we'll get our installation options. So first, let's go ahead and create our partition, and we will not be using GPT. The reason why for this is GPT is mainly for EFI machines, and we're using a Generation 1 machine, not a Gen 2 VM, so we're going to go ahead and say no. Now, we need to create a partition. Right now, there are no partitions installed, so go ahead and click New, Primary, and go ahead and click Enter for the default size. Then hit Enter or select Bootable to make it bootable, and we'll just maximize in case the default size wasn't max already. Then we're going to go ahead and select Write, and then we have to type in Yes. We'll write the partition table to the disk, and then we just have to wait a few seconds for this to finish. Once that's done, we can now quit. Now we have to actually format that partition we created. So let's go ahead and select the partition we just created. It's SDA1. And we'll format it as ext4. And yes, we are sure. And we'll wait for this to continue. This may take a while. It may seem like nothing's happening. It may stay at 0% for, I don't know, anywhere from a few seconds to like a few minutes, depending on how fast your machine is. In practice, what will probably happen is this will stay at 0, and you'll see it jump to 100, and it'll be done. You just have to wait. So for now, I'm just going to wait this out, and I may pause the recording here. Okay, so we're back. That took just slightly over 10 minutes. That was about 13 minutes. I was keeping a rough estimate, but I'll put the timer on when I'm editing the video. So the next step is we want to install the bootloader, so go ahead and click Yes. And this option now depends on what you're using Android for. The system directory could be either read-only or read-write. I'm going to go ahead and make it read-write. This option may depend on if you specifically know you do not want your system directory to be write and only be read-only, go ahead and select no. But for this tutorial, I'm going to make it read-write. Now, right after this is when we install Android, so this now may actually take a while as well. So I'm going to let it do its thing, and then when we come back, we can adjust the grub settings. So now that Android x86 has been installed, we need to eject our installation media. So let's go ahead and eject ISO. And now we're not going to run Android. We have to actually adjust the boot parameters in grub. So we're going to go ahead and reboot. Let that happen. And next, we're going to boot in the debug mode. There's actually a very good reason for this. We have to adjust the grub setting to allow our proper display output. Otherwise, we'll just get a command line rather than seeing the Android UI. Now, this also takes a while. If you're running Hyper-V specifically, we have to wait for one line in particular, and it's actually a string. It should start with 50, and it's going to be HV balloon. This is just basically the debug output. We have to wait for everything to load first. And what we're going to do is, once we get to that see that string up here, we can go ahead and select enter on our keyboard, and it will drop us down into a shell. So this should only take about 30 seconds to a minute. Once that's done, I'll be back. All right, so this is the last string we're waiting for, so go ahead and hit enter on your keyboard. And I have to let Hyper-V grab my keyboard. So go ahead, click enter. You'll get the root shell. And so the first thing we have to do is go to the directory where the grub settings are saved. So we're going to do cd for change directory /mnt for mount, and then grub. Now we can go ahead and type in ls to make sure all the files we need are here. And this is the grub menu that we'll be adjusting. So what we want to do is we want to make a backup copy of that menu. So we're going to do cp for copy, menu.lst, and then we'll copy it to like menu.lst.back. This is just a backup file. You can name your backup whatever you'd like. So now that that's out of the way, we can actually edit the menu file. So we're going to use the text editor vi, and then we'll edit menu.lst. So we need to adjust this first entry for normal boot mode. So go ahead and this quiet parameter, we'll delete that. So press I on your keyboard to insert text, and then we're going to delete this and set VGA equal to, in my case, it's going to be 792. And so these are actually, VGA equal to 792. These are actually Linux VGA BIOS parameters. This basically determines the resolution and color depth. I can actually pull up a Wikipedia page for you guys so you can see the Linux video mode numbers. We want to look at 24-bit and basically choose a number that's not in red. So in my case, I'm doing 792. That's a 1024 by 768 resolution, and you have to do 24-bit, otherwise Android will not render properly. So now that that's done, we can go ahead and press escape, and then we'll hit colon, let's see down here, and then we're going to do write, which is W, and hit enter. So we wrote the changes, then we're going to do colon and Q for quit. Now, we've saved the changes. There's pretty much nothing left for us to do in this debug mode. So we can go ahead and just send a Ctrl-Alt-Delete to reboot. And now we can actually go ahead and press Enter, and Android will boot properly. As you can see, our screen resolution changed, and you'll at first get dropped down to this text, to the shell. Do not type or touch anything. Give it a few seconds, and the graphical user interface will start up. And that's what we're seeing right now. So just give it a few seconds, and this is the Android GUI loading. This is going to take a while as well. The first boot always takes a while. After that, it's usually faster. And of course, if you allocate more CPU and more memory, or just have it on a SSD or a faster device, this load times will be decreased. So let's just wait for this to boot up. So Android is just basically almost done booting. You can see this is an out-of-box experience. Unfortunately, the mouse integration really sucks with Hyper-V. Notice I clicked here and the mouse is here. So don't expect to use the mouse. If you have a touch input device like a Surface Pro, supposedly this works a lot better than using your mouse to input. But for now, I'd recommend actually just using the arrow keys to navigate. So you can use tab, your up, down, left, right arrows, and enter. So that's what I'm going to do. Go ahead, select the next button. I may have to actually select it with the mouse. So, like I said, this is very wonky. This may happen. This is one of the downsides of Android x86. Stuff happens. It doesn't always run smoothly. So let's try again. So I go ahead and select next. And since we don't actually have Wi-Fi, we actually connected using a virtual Ethernet adapter. We have to skip this step. And we're gonna the mouse integration, so we're gonna go ahead and skip anyway using the tab key and the enter key. Then finally, we'll just go through a quick run through what's left to finish, and you should be golden after this, I believe. You should boot up to the home screen. Then we got more opt-outs. So Android x86 is an open source project, and it's maintained by volunteers. So you can decide whether or not you want to send hardware and app usage information. Go ahead and say, got it. And then you're basically done. We're in Android x86. Give it a few seconds to load up all of the apps. I may be running this with a little bit less memory than it needs. So take that for what it's worth. Let's see, assign memory. See, it's saying it's demanding 23 gigs of memory. That's a little much. So yeah, definitely maybe up the memory from, you know, what I put as 1024, maybe like 2 gigs should be more than enough, especially since now we have Android running. I like using the arrow keys to navigate, just because the mouse integration sucks. So now let's actually enable ADB, and we're going to enable ADB over TCP IP, just because we can't actually have a USB connection to our virtual machine. So what we're gonna do, actually Android x86 comes with SuperUser pre-installed, and it's technically rooted. So we're gonna go ahead and give ourselves SuperUser access, and it's gonna take a while again. When it asks, just go ahead and give yourself SU access for like 10 minutes. So yeah, I'm going to tell it to remember the choice for 10 minutes. I'm going to allow this. So now we can go ahead and enable ADB. So we're going to do set prop service. It's service.adb.tcp. dot port, and then the default port is usually 5555. Then we're going to stop the ADB service, and then we'll be started. And that's about it. You are now done setting up Android x86 to run under Hyper-V. That's about all you need to know. So one other thing I wanted to mention before I end this video is that once we are done installing Android in Hyper-V, we no longer need to use the Hyper-V like RDP connection. We can actually do something like run a VNC server on Android, or we could use utilities that make use of ADB. And for example, I can pull up a few, such as Visor. This essentially uses an ADB connection to mirror your phone screen, and it takes inputs fairly decently. There's also AirDroid. And we can actually use something called ADB control, and it's you can find it on this guy's website. If you know what you're doing, there's a handful of utilities you can use, so you're not necessarily tied down to one thing. But if you're going to be using ADB, you most likely will not need the GUI. So you can go ahead and actually close it and just leave it running in the background. And then when you want to turn on or shut down, you can always shut down. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. And that's basically it. That's how to run Android under Hyper-V. I hope you guys found this useful. Leave a comment down below. Let me know what you think. I hope this helps you guys.